Hi, everyone. My name is Terek. I'm from Snap. I work on spectacles, and I'm really thrilled that, we get to a chance to talk to you guys about sort of like the glasses and AI. I think there's sort of like maybe like a secret that we feel we know that like no other people don't yet in some ways when thinking about sort of like AI and AR. So what I'm going to talk to you over the next little while is just sort of like the amazing ways you can use AI with the glasses. It'll give a hint of sort of like what we're working on with the Supabase team. Can't talk about it just yet. A couple more weeks, there'll be some really exciting announcements regarding that. But the one thing that I was going to take you through a very, very brief preview, glasses has been a thing at Snap for the last decade or so. We kind of started with two different pairs of glasses that you could just camera glasses. And along the way, we're like, you know what? Let's just make the jump to a computer. Or a spatial computer that you can actually wear. And then the last one we released in September, the idea was to actually put the power of that spatial computer in the hands of developers like you, which is kind of like how we even got to learn about the amazing Supabase community and the care that's giving in sort of like building that developer experience. So when it comes to spectacles, I'll just kind of like give you a quick preview of the product. One interesting thing that we try to do in this product is to build a product that's truly standalone. The entire compute happens on device. Nothing goes to the cloud for rendering or any of those purposes. The way we achieve that is by basically distributing the compute through two SoCs. So there's actually two SoCs on each one of the sides of the glasses. And the reason for that is because heat. The interesting thing about glasses is that the more compute you run, the more heat you produce. Computers, if you remember back in the day, had like active cooling with fans and what have you. But with this kind of product, you cannot do that. You rely on basically the surface area and just having that heat exchange with the surrounding environment, which is not very fast. And the interesting thing is like people want it to be smaller. So you lose more of the surface area and they want it to do more. So you have to increase the compute at the same time trying to deal with the heat. It's a very complex set of trade-offs. I'd say one of the most amazing things about the way that we think about this product is just how we thoughtfully think about each and every single trade-off we have to make along the way. And sometimes those trade-offs are years into the future where certain things happen along the way. Which brings me to one of the most exciting things that has happened in the last 2 years. I personally have been working on glasses for the last decade at three different companies. And there's always this thing about augmented reality is like two things. Number one is that it augments your world, right? You can put things in the world. And then the other half was all about, people call it contextual computing. It's just the fact that a computer can actually understand what is going on in your world the same way that you reason about it, right? That was an impossible problem in some ways because you could never kind of get it to do it just right. And lo and behold, 2 years ago, something came out of nowhere, multimodal LLMs and some of the computers can kind of reason about the world in a very similar way that we do. And that unlocks something I would say like truly, like, I don't know, for someone like me personally, it's like astounding what is now possible. And what we're going to talk about briefly is some of those things and why spectacles is particularly suited for anyone who is actually thinking about where is the terminal destination of AI in our lives. I reckon it's probably not just exchanges of text or even voice, if you think about it, right? There's a bunch of dimensions that are missing. So we'll talk about spatial awareness, real-time custom object tracking, seamless voice input, 3D object generation, and spatial reasonings with LLMs. So with spectacles, when you actually use the product, the entire experience is actually grounded in the world in front of you. Objects interact with your environment. They can be anchored to different things around the world you're in, and you're basically able to interact with them. That actually adds this sense of realism, blending sort of like what you do physically with what you're doing digitally, right? As you can see here, this is an example where somebody's using a drum set, and they're able to get feedback in real time about how they're playing the drums and help them get better. One that I'm particularly excited about is this idea of real-time object tracking, particularly for custom objects. So it's not just about recognizing there's an object in the scene, but actually being able to track it in real time and understand what you're doing with it. With that, you can basically turn any physical object into a controller for a digital experience. You can see here on the left, example is basically tracking the chess pieces and understanding what you're doing. You're just kind of like doing chess, right? Which is kind of like the magic of AR glasses in general, is that you're just doing what you do. And with augmented reality, it's kind of just complementing what you're doing rather than replacing it. Same with the piano here. I used to not know how to play the piano. I still don't know, but at least I can play a song. And that was just basically through this process of just like watching, playing the piano and getting that aid directly in my field of view versus looking down on my phone or an iPad or something like that.
Yeah.
Same thing applies to pool, like that example in the bottom left, as well as the basketball example here, where it's kind of fascinating because the glasses are actually tracking that ball in real time and recognizing that it actually entered the net and just updating the score. Again, it's not like actually changing the experience of playing basketball. It's just augmenting it. And I think this is just the beginning, especially now where there's a lot of exciting ways that you can turn these. So these object trackers run on device using a feature we call SnapML, where you can deploy them and you can actually understand what your users are doing. Over the last little while, we also added a lot of support for recognizing what you're saying through LLMs. I think it's a well-understood concept, and it powers already a lot of experiences like translation and all those standard use cases. And I think the interesting thing about everything you see here, those are all built using the same tools that we make available to developers. We have a rule internally that we don't use internal APIs as much. We build the same with the same APIs that we make available to our developers, because that's how we maintain a level of developer experience that at least, you know, matches our own expectations. Another interesting thing that that you can do with the glasses is they provide you with access to the camera, so you can actually generate 3D objects that can keep your experience fresh and actually more responsive to the interactions that you're doing in the real world. There's an example here where one of the lenses that we call Imagine Together, where you can basically imagine objects and they get generated. 3D objects get generated in real time. And this is actually a multiplayer experience. So there's actually multiple people experiencing that and they can counter pass these objects to each other. This feature is the one that I'm most excited about. I think it's just like the shows sort of the magic of like when you combine that multimodal capabilities. So you can, for example, send in a camera frame to an LLM. The LLMs of today can actually reason about like what's in the image. They'll spit back at you a coordinate in that image, an XY coordinate. But when you send that original image, I might be looking at a gentleman over there wearing the black attire there. And by the time it goes to the LLM, let's say, for example, which person is wearing the black attire, I might have looked that way. But I need the annotation to be on that person. So it's able to go back in time and actually match that. And you don't have to do much as a developer. That is done for you. So that you can start to begin to understand sort of like what becomes possible. It becomes a sort of like a situation where the AI's output sometimes might be even very subtly changing what's around you and showing you a different version of how you experience the world. See a bunch of examples here. The Stanosaur example is my favorite, where it's able to show you sort of the different bones, as well as fixing your car or learning about plants or what have you. So one big question that comes up when looking at all this power that these types of experiences has, particularly with a product like this, with cameras that can see what you see, hear what you hear, is a big question about privacy and how you handle that. There's not a lot I can share about that, but this is part of the reason, for example, we're thinking about some of those things. How do you build infrastructure that's privacy first? Building more to share about that into the future, but I think it's just keeping in mind that with all this power that with AI and the access it has to a product like this, where the data goes and where it lives becomes a pretty important question. Last but not least, we are going to be here tomorrow. The team is here. They brought a lot of devices. We love hackathons. We go all around the country at universities and run hackathons, so it's just like kind of like our jam. The team told us here that they're running a hackathon. Like, perfect. We brought in the glasses. We brought in our team that basically cycles through these hackathons, and we're ready to help out. But in order to build on those glasses, you're going to have to use Lens Studio. I just was going to mention for all of you what's awesome about Lens Studio, so I'll do it really quickly to be respectful of time. Number one, it has a built-in simulator, so you're actually able to try whatever you're building right away. When you're building these types of spatial experiences, you really have to feel it. So a lot of the time, you really need to push it to the glasses to experience what it's like in the real world. Because we don't compile the code, it's based TypeScript based, we are able to actually push to the glasses right away without waiting for a couple minutes for the code to compile and then for you to actually put it on the device. So that makes your workflow, which is probably the most impactful thing, because this medium is still so new that it's kind of hard to know like what actually feels right. There's a lot of iterations that you have to go through as a developer to actually appreciate how to place this content or how to design your interactions. Within the simulator itself, we also support hot launching, hot reload. So we will, as you're making changes, it'll automatically reflect in your preview. The preview has basically representations of real life scenarios as well, like walking on the boardwalk or what have you. So it's able to give you a sense, at least as you're developing, of what the experience would be like of someone wearing the glasses. We also offer an asset library that has a lot of free assets to help you get started. Also, there's some helpers that might help you attach certain behaviors to your experience. We recently also added TypeScript support because we thought there's like the complexity of these experiences is increasing. Teams want to work together and just want to have a better handle on like how to exchange code amongst each other without having to reason about like how somebody might have written their code. And last but not least, we have like a handful of SDKs that are specific for spectacles. So we have something called the Interaction Kit that helps you add interactions to your UIs. We have a UI kit that has a bunch of the UIs that are common in the system. They use the system design language. So if you don't want to reinvent everything, containers, those types of behaviors, how you resize things, as well as a navigation kit that can help you create guided navigation experiences in certain locations, if that's what you want to do. And we have many more planned. Actually, in 2 weeks, we'll probably be announcing a bunch of more that basically help accelerate the development experience. So a couple of thoughts I'll leave you with is please check them out. We are in the at the entrance of the other building. Team will be happy to give you a demo. Join our Reddit, reddit.com/r/spectacles. You can get a glimpse of sort of like what everyone else is building, what type of questions, what are they doing with this. And last but not least, if you are a developer, you're excited about trying this, apply. You can download the Spectacles app. We're currently only making this product available to developers. And next year, we will be launching our Specs 2026, which is our first consumer version of this. All I can say, it's much smaller and it is even bigger field of view, and lots of exciting stuff that we'll start sharing with you all. So if you want to build for that future, please stop by and we're happy to answer any questions you may have. And once again, thanks to the Supabase team for having us here. We're super thrilled to work with them, and I think there's going to be a lot of great things that are going to come out of this in the future. So thanks so much.